So, I would like now to go into some detail about techniques, especially the modeling techniques, which is a big part of what we are going to do this week. So, maybe first of all, just show you a little bit the task ontology that we are using. This is developed by Martijn van Weeden, who was my PhD student long ago, and part of his PhD was to develop tools for supporting task analysis. And we discovered, or he discovered, that there's a lot of related stuff, but in a way, using this set of concepts and relations, you can pretty much model anything in task analysis that anybody ever has tried to model. Task analysis from the point of view of the users and stakeholders, that is. I'm talking about a few from people. Now, the good news is that in the website that Teresa has been prepared, the resources website on task analysis, you can find this ontology in a way that when it starts, it just shows you task, and then you hear me talk, and while I'm talking, you hear me describe all the relations. So I'm not going to completely do this, but I would just like to say that tasks could have subtasks. Tasks are normally performed by agents, people, machines, institutes. Agents play roles. Roles is feeling responsible or being responsible for performing a task. Tasks use objects. Objects can contain other objects. A folder can contain files. A file can contain lines. A line can contain words, and so on. Objects are used by agents in certain roles. And tasks, by the way, have goals, and tasks can have sub-goals, and then there are events that trigger tasks that need to be performed by engineers. Now, this is the whole story. And the story is on the website in detail, and on the website you can hear me explain the story in 5 or 10 minutes, so I'm just skipping it now, but I'm telling you, you have access to that already now, it's there. You have seen this picture before, this is what we are going to talk about. We are going to talk about modeling the knowledge that we acquire from here, from the users, from the situation, from the documents, and later on knowledge that's changed by you because the agent asks you to do things and the technology allows you or prevents you to do things. Right? Okay. So, task model 1, collecting task knowledge. So how can we find out what's going on in the shop of our clients today? Right? What's the current situation? Bridget Jordan, who is an ethnographer, in 1996 wrote down a very nice description of what I consider task analysis, even though she was an ethnographer, but she has a very broad view of all different possibilities. And she tells us task knowledge with people is partly explicit, so which means that people can talk about it or people can write about it. So, The top level is about explicit knowledge. Some knowledge you can ask your peers, or somebody you can ask an expert and they will explain. Some knowledge you can find, like there's knowledge on the door that tells me what to do if I leave the room. I should switch off the beamer and I should leave anything as I found it, right? So this is knowledge that's in the environment. And there's implicit knowledge. I'm able to do things. My secretary is able to have a document signed by the authorized person. Even if she cannot speak about it, she still managed to do this, right? And then there's implicit group knowledge, which we label culture or community of practice or word practice. So now on the other hand, there's some knowledge, that is the left part, which is knowledge by individuals. People have knowledge and they can talk about it. It's like their facts, heuristics, skills, and there's things people can do without talking about it. You could label this intuition or expertise, but people can do it. And sometimes say, well, it's obvious that you do it this way, and I cannot explain how, but I can show you. And then there's knowledge that's not knowledge in people's head, but it's knowledge in the group. I don't know what's actually printed on the door. None of you do, but we know where to find it. Right? It's knowledge of us, knowledge that belongs to the group, to this society. Could be rules, instructions, you could say these are rules or instructions. Could also be anecdotes, right? And historic documents. And there's implicit group knowledge. So this is how we work together. Right? So So it could be implicit that when we have a coffee break, it lasts 15 minutes. I did say 15 minutes, but apparently we do. Right? So, okay. So these are four different, you could say, knowledge sources. And for each of these knowledge sources, you might need different techniques to capture that knowledge, to find it. Because this knowledge you can ask, but this knowledge asking doesn't work. And this knowledge asking doesn't work either. Right? Good. If you don't mind to continue.